Hello, everyone. My name is Anam Jangshe, and I'm a product manager at AWS. Today, I'm super excited to show you how you can get started with Amazon Aurora Serverless V2. You're going to learn an overview of what is Aurora Serverless V2. We're going to look at some of the key concepts, and we'll close off with a demo where I'm going to show you how you can get started quickly. So first off, to set context, what is Amazon Aurora? It is a MySQL and Postgres compatible relational database that's built for the cloud. It's a fully managed database. It gives you the performance and availability that you would expect from a commercial database, but at just 1/10 the price. And it is also the fastest growing service in the history of AWS. When you look at your end-to-end technical stack, your database is one of the key components there. Now, you don't want to run into a situation where you don't have enough database capacity to run these workloads. And typically with these workloads, you see tons of variability. And you don't want to be in a situation where you provision for less than peak capacity, your application is going to experience degradation because there wasn't sufficient capacity. So what you'll end up doing is you'll provision for peak capacity. But this is a very expensive solution because most of the time, you're not using any of this capacity. You're just paying for it. So to save on costs, what you probably end up doing is you continuously monitor the database and you scale up and down when it's needed. Now, one, this incurs downtime. And secondly, it's pretty tedious to do. So here, we're talking about just one database. Imagine you have hundreds and thousands of databases, which is typical of a SaaS scenario, where you have hundreds and thousands of customers, and each of these customers have a database of their own. Or you have an application which has lots and lots of database connected to it. So having to manage all of these databases becomes a pretty daunting task. So this is where Aurora Serverless V2 comes in, which is a feature of Aurora. It gives you the capability to scale automatically, and it follows a simple pay-per-use pricing model. So you only pay for what you're using. It scales instantly, and it makes sure that follows your workload closely, so you're not paying for anything additional. So it supports even your most demanding business-critical production workload, where you require high scale and high availability, as well as your development and test environments. So Aurora Serverless V2 also supports the full breadth of Aurora features. Now, let's talk about some of the key concepts, starting off with the architecture. So one of the key components of the architecture is separation of storage and compute. And it is this separation that allows us to scale the compute and storage separately. So let's talk about the storage layer. Here, you have a purpose-built, log-structured distributed storage. Always, 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 your storage will be spread across three availability zones, and the storage grows and shrinks based on the size of your data. Now we save 6 copies of your data across these 3 availability zones. If something happens to one copy, no worries, there are 5 other copies. If the whole availability zone goes out, for example, we still have 4 other copies. So this is how we ensure that you get high availability, durability, and performance. Now talking about compute, if you have a single availability zone deployment, you have a writer node, which is connected to your storage node with read and write intent. Now, it also gives you the capability to deploy up to 15 read replicas to be able to scale your reads. Now, if this architecture seems familiar, it is because this is Aurora's architecture that we build Aurora Serverless V2 on top of. Now, where does Serverless V2 comes in? It gives you the capability to scale each of these readers and writer node up and down based on your workload. Now, how does that work? So at provisioning time, what you do is you specify database capacity. You specify a minimum database capacity and a maximum database capacity. And what Serverless V2 does it, it scales in place within this capacity range that you have provided. Now, we measure capacity in Aurora capacity units or ACUs. Now to think about what does that mean, one ACU, it comes with 2 GB of memory. And for CPU and networking, it's similar to what you get with provisioned Aurora instances. and we make sure that we scale the database in fine-grained increments so it follows closely your workload. So we can scale as little as 0.5 ACU increments. So let's take an example. If your workload is at 16 ACUs, we can jump to as small as 16.5, or we can make bigger jumps depending on your workload. Now, this is how you set the capacity for the database. Now, what factors do we take into consideration to figure out when to scale the database or how to scale the database? Now, there are various factors. We look at, for example, CPU utilization. So this is not just the foreground processes, such as the queries that you're running. We also look at the background processes. So when you require more CPU, we'll scale the database up to make sure that you get those resources. The second factor that we take into consideration is memory pressure on your internal data structures. For example, you have buffer pool. So we make sure if your database requires resources, we scale it up. The third factor is network throughput. Again, if your workload requires resources, we're going to scale the database up to provide it the resources that your workload requires. Now, one other factor to keep in mind is that the scaling rates that we follow, these are predictable scaling rates. So the bigger the database, the faster it'll scale. So the scaling rate that you will get at, let's say, 16 ACUs is going to be faster than the scaling rate that you will get at 8 ACUs. So these are some of the factors that we take into consideration to figure out when to scale your database and how to scale it up. Now, let's dive into a demo to see how you can get started. So first demo that I want to show you is how simple and easy it is to create Aurora Serverless V2. So here, we're in the RDS console. To create a database, you just click the Create Database button. Now, this flow is similar to what you have already seen before with RDS and Aurora. And as I mentioned to you, Serverless V2 is a feature of Aurora. So in engine options, we're going to select Amazon Aurora. Once I select it, in the editions now, I can see that both MySQL and Postgres compatible editions are supported for Aurora Serverless V2. So for MySQL, let's see if I want to figure out, you know, what versions are available. In the filter, I'm just going to select to see serverless options. And you can see MySQL 8 is supported currently for Aurora Serverless V2. And for Postgres, if I look in the drop-down menu, it's Postgres 13 and 14. And of course, future versions that will come in will be supported with Aurora Serverless V2. Let's just quickly give it an identifier and a password. Now, here's the interesting bit. So with provision, you are used to selecting machine size. So here, you know, you have R6Gs, R5Gs. Now, if I go and select serverless option, that changes to capacity range. Now, you're not selecting a fixed machine size. You're specifying the capacity range that we talked about earlier. You're going to give it a minimum capacity and a maximum capacity, and the database will scale in place between this range. So there's no failover happening. This is how we make sure that there's no disruption in scaling. So here you can also set your, if you want a multi-AZ deployment or not. For the purpose of this demo, I'm just going to say no, and we'll scroll down here. As you can see, you can select performance insights. So as I mentioned, Aurora Serverless V2 supports the full breadth of Aurora features, so things like performance insights, RDS proxy, and multi-AZ deployment. For the rest of the options, I'm just selected default and click Create Database. So here, once the status says available, your database is going to be ready so you can connect to it. And here I can click on this database to see additional properties, and in connectivity, I see the endpoints right there. This is what you use to connect to your database. And that's it. You have your database ready to be connected to. Now, if you're an existing Aurora customer, so here I have a cluster which already has a provisioned instance. So I have an R5 large instance. Now, if I want to add serverless, all I have to do is I go to this cluster. In actions, what I'm going to do is add a reader. Now, this step is the typical adding any reader within an Aurora cluster. So I click Add Reader. And in instance configuration now, I'm going to say the reader would be serverless V2. And I specify capacity range. So the setting I'm putting in at cluster level, and all my instances that are serverless will inherit this setting. So for the rest of the option, I'm just going to go ahead and select the defaults, so I don't have to do anything. And I'm going to click Add Reader. So now it's adding a reader within this Aurora cluster, which is serverless. Once the status stays available in this cluster now, you have two instances. So you have a serverless reader and a provision writer. So as you can see in the size, it specifies like which one is serverless V2. And for the writer instance, it shows the size that this is R5 large. So this is a mixed configuration cluster. It has both the flavors. Now, if I want my reader instance that I just selected to be the writer, all I do is failover. And here I'm going to say yes, failover. And I'm going to wait for the process to finish. So that's all you had to do. If you notice now, the serverless is a writer instance and your provision is a reader instance. So this way, just by using a failover option, you can switch back and forth between your serverless and provision. And failover would typically take you less than 30 seconds. And if you're using RDS proxy, it'll take you less than 10 seconds. So now let's talk about scaling. So for scaling, I want to use a simple event-driven application. Here you have like a fun question, a user choice of, you know, if you want to figure out what kind of platform people prefer. So for this application, once the user casts forward, the database is going to see a load happening, and it will need to scale up to support this workload. So this is just a sample question. Let's generate some load on this database now. So I'm going to use Artillery for generating load on the database. So once it starts, I'm switching to CloudWatch now. Here you see a CloudWatch dashboard. We're going to use this to observe scaling. With the blue line, what it shows is database capacity that I mentioned in ACUs. So what you want to see is as we start the voting event, users are going to register, they're going to start casting their vote. So there's workload coming in, and this blue line will respond to that workload coming in. So here you see brown and red lines appearing. That means users are coming in, registering. And you see the blue line, which is the database capacity, it starts going up to accommodate that request. And now there are a lot more users coming in. So you saw that instantaneous scaling. The peaks that you notice, it's because CPU resources, for example, are easier to give. So you see that instant spike there, and then memory follows and the database capacity levels off. Now with the load coming in with the brown and the red lines, now the database capacity has leveled off, so it can support that workload that the application is bringing in right now. If the load increases further, your database will scale up to support that. So the voting is continuing. You see more users coming in, registering and casting their vote. And the database capacity is supporting this workload. So now you observe that the red line, which is the user registration, it went down. And the voting also went down. So this shows that the voting period has ended. But the database capacity didn't drop directly. You see this intentional stepwise decrease? This is because we want to make sure that we don't take away resources prematurely from the database and impact your workload coming in. So once we were sure the event has ended, the database capacity slowly scales down. And it'll go back down all the way to the minimum capacity that you specified. Here is a quick look at the results that we're seeing, and it's a pretty even divide. So now to bring it all together, what you saw in this demo was first with how just a few clicks, you can get started with Aurora Serverless V2. How if you're already in a customer of Aurora, you can add a reader and get started with Serverless V2, and how it scales corresponding to your workload. And it follows the workload as closely as possible, so you only pay for what you're using and nothing more. I can't wait to see everything that you will build with Aurora Serverless V2. Thank you for joining, everyone.